My name is Franz Branderhorst, and welcome to St. Thomas Online.
Again, and I invite you to recite with me the Collect for Purity. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, whose Son revealed in signs and miracles the wonder of your saving presence, renew your people with your heavenly grace, and in all of our weakness, sustain us by your mighty power. This we ask through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Listen now, for God speaks to us in the words of Holy Scripture.
A reading from the book of Jonah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up and go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it its message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go to the city, going on a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 more days, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on a sackcloth. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. The word of the Lord.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat, mending their nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men, and they followed him. Gospel of Christ. This reading from the Gospel of Mark follows very quickly on the reading which we had last week from John's Gospel, in which Philip had been sitting under a fig tree and Jesus recognized him not only as a potential disciple, but is as someone in whom there was no deceit, no dishonesty, no what you see is what you can get kind of thing. So what was obvious that he was a righteous man was also true of him. Now, let me point out that the only person that we have come into contact with who is perfectly human and yet without sin was Jesus. So Nathanael may have had a few issues. Regardless, we now switch back again to Mark's Gospel. And in Mark's Gospel, we began this morning's reading at verse 14 of chapter 1. We are not far into Mark's Gospel before Jesus is calling his disciples. We have been through the story of John the Baptist, who came before Jesus as the Elijah, the one who was to come. And immediately after John the Baptist was arrested, Jesus comes to Galilee proclaiming the good news. And his comment about all this, Jesus' comment, is that the time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. 2 points I want to make about this. One is that the very beginning of this says, now after John was arrested, Mark is telling us the exact time, really, when the preaching of Jesus began in Galilee. It began when John was, or right after John was arrested. Elijah, the prophet who was to come before the Messiah, has left the scene. Elijah too, if you will, has left the scene. And as soon as that happens, the Son of God begins his preaching ministry in Galilee. And he tells them that the kingdom of God has come near, not in the sense of anything that's happening in the world, certainly not in the sense of the arrest of John, which would lead to his, you know, decapitation. But the kingdom of God comes near in the person of Jesus Christ. It's not anything that in particular that has gone on in the world. It's the presence of Jesus Christ. And so whenever, for example, we are able to celebrate the Eucharist either together or from a distance, the kingdom of God has come near because the presence of Jesus Christ is near, which is why it is so important to me to do those spiritual Eucharists. I know that you can't always be there, but at least the presence of God is there. The kingdom of God is there in that moment because of that. Repent. The interesting thing about repent is that we tend to use that as a repent from your sins kind of thing. That's the way that modern English uses that particular word, or repent from your wrongdoings, for example. But in medieval English and sort of before the modern era, the word repent and the word regret in English both meant very much the same thing. Does it make a difference to say regret and believe in the good news? And I think it does. Because what this is saying is not, oh gosh, we're so awful. We just want to put away all our sins. You know, dear God, haven't we been terrible? What this is saying is, I regret maybe the way that my life has been before. I regret that I have not spent enough time in prayer, in conversation with Jesus. I regret perhaps that sometimes my humanness creeps in and I am nasty to people. Now, hopefully that doesn't happen very often, but the point is that we are human, and everything from a headache to being tired can cause us to snap into the lowest common denominator of that humanity almost right away. God knows that. God knows we're human. Rather than saying repent at that point, maybe the right word is, I regret having been that way. You know, I look back on many things in my teenage and young adult life, and I regret them. I don't have any huge regrets, and I could go back and do my life again. But you know, there are things I would have done differently. I think I would have been kinder to people in high school that I didn't like. I think I would have spent more time walking around the Hockley Valley, because I sure miss those walks now. When Tony and I were married and we had young children in the house, I was doing my degree at Trinity College at the University of Toronto. And I was often busy and missed weekends with them, and I regret that. That wasn't a terrible sin, by the way, and lots of people do it. But of course, now that they're moved away from home and they have lives of their own, I regret it. It's something I think knowing what I know now, I might very well change. The idea is to regret not just our big sins, but perhaps regret the way our lives have been, and believing in the good news, believing in the presence of God, take a new direction. Sit on the other side. Sit on the side of looking after yourself and being more fully human than perhaps we ever thought we could be. And that doesn't mean beating ourselves up over what has come in the past. That means rejoicing in the presence of Christ in this moment, calling us, just like last week's phone call during the sermon, to turn around and look at him and follow him in what he's done. Because that believing is the path to our salvation. And if you can hang on to that, even in these really terrible moments of COVID and being locked down and being scared and being lonely and being uncertain, then I think you might realize, just like I have, that following is even more important now than it might have been before. Amen.
Let us confess the faith of our baptism as we say together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Father, you called the apostles Simon, Andrew, James, and John to follow you. Help us to be fishers of men, to open up our hearts to those we come in contact with. Let us share stories of your love, your unfailing goodness, and mercy to those who are searching for your light. Breathe, inspire, and guide us so that we can always be true followers of you. We pray for those who have not yet encountered your love, the many in our community who stand back from matters of faith, who look doubtfully at those of us who believe. We pray for those who are seeking you, those who have lost their faith, and those whose lives are deformed by the lack of truth. We pray for those who live in darkness, that they may find the true light to guide their footsteps to a brighter future. Lord, you have called us to be your disciples. We pray for passionate preachers that you have equipped, for our rector, Kevin, our honorary assistants, Philip, John, and Jason, for all who have ministries at our Church of St. Thomas and beyond. We pray that the Holy Spirit will open their eyes, hearts, and minds to the loveliness of God's wisdom. We pray for those known to us who have needs. We pray for our families and people we miss due to this lockdown. We pray for those suffering of ill health, those who are in isolation, and those with uncertainty for the future. We pray for people who are confused by the many choices they now face due to this pandemic. Gracious Father, keep them strong and encouraged even in the midst of heartache and disappointment. Holy One, hear all our prayers and let our cry come on to you. Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Would you join me, please, in the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Thank you. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Peace of the Lord be always with you and with those you love. Go now in peace to love and to serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. And may God protect all of us.
My name is Emily, and I'm the fundraising coordinator here at Start Me Up Niagara. I am talking to you today about our Coldest Night of the Year event, which is our annual and biggest fundraiser. It is happening on February 20th, so it's coming up soon. And we really hope that we'll have your support this year. The team really raised a lot last year, and we really appreciated all your hard work. And we hope that we'll have you again this year. All of the money that is raised will be used locally, so to help the homeless right in our community here in the St. Catharines area. And the need is really higher than ever. COVID really does impact people who are homeless. They have a lack of public facilities, takeout stores, everything. They don't have anywhere to go. So really, Start Me Up Niagara is the place that they go for a little bit of shelter, a warm beverage, and some food in their bellies as well. Also, we're preventing homelessness. So people who have lost their jobs due to COVID, we're trying to make them stay off the streets. So that's another big reason why we are doing this work that we are now. The need is higher than ever before. But we really need your support this year to help with things that go on in our drop-in center, like the warm beverages and the food. We also provide a lot of help for them as well when they come into our facility. We'll help them with anything that they need, whether that's getting in touch with medical personnel, making appointments. So we really do need your assistance with that so we can keep on going. But despite COVID, we are all in this together. So we really hope we can rely on your support this year. So thanks so much, and I hope to see you If you have any questions, please reach out to Diane, or you can reach out to myself as well. So my name is Emily again, and you can reach me at fundraising@startmeupniagara.ca. So thanks so much.